Well, hello on this Tuesday evening. Thanks so much for tuning in to Healthline. I'll be your host tonight. I'm Jennifer Blomquist. And in case you're not familiar with Healthline, this is a live program. Yes, we all drove here in the snow, and it is live, and we welcome any questions you may have. The topic, of course, tonight is orthopedics. And tonight we have an orthopedic specialist who specializes in the foot. So we would like you to call with any questions pertaining to that part of the body. And we're going to keep the phone number up for you at the bottom of the screen. So the phone lines are open right now. And we'll keep them open until just about 8 o'clock. So it's 969-2720, and then it's still toll-free just in case you're outside of Fort Wayne. Just tack an 866 in front of there, and that'll get you through as well, and we'll get you on the air to ask your question. And if you're too shy to ask it live, still give us a call. They can just tell me what you want me to ask the doctor, and I'll ask him for you. So let's go ahead and meet our guest tonight, who is kind enough to come out in this lousy weather. Thank you so much, Dr. McManus.
My pleasure.
We appreciate you being here. And again, Dr. McManus's specialty is the foot. And I see you brought a model with you as well, so we're going to be referencing that. And we can take your questions at any time, even though we're having a discussion. We welcome your questions at any time. Now the phone lines are open. Well, why don't we first talk about the model, because I think sometimes people forget just how delicate the foot is. I mean, I'm looking at those bones, and they don't look like they could support a lot, but they must be able to.
It's a very complex structure. The bones are put together in such a way that it really creates a stable structure to walk, and all the other activities we do, running, jumping, and
yeah,
it's pretty incredible how much stress that these feet undergo every day. So,
what are some of the things, well, you wanted to talk tonight about a condition, and I'm trying to get this right, the pronunciation, plantar fasciitis. Right. What exactly is that?
Well, the plantar fascia is actually a ligament, which is a tough band of connective tissue that stretches from the toes to the bottom of the heel bone. It's important in supporting the arch. When we step down, it pulls tight. Mm. It's not real stretchy, though, and under certain circumstances, if the ligament pulls and strains too much, the bottom of the heel, where it becomes, where it's attached, becomes inflamed, and that creates pain, of course.
Sure, yeah. what kinds of things would cause an issue with it?
Well, the risk factors for plantar fasciitis, obesity is one.
Okay,
extra weight puts more stress and pressure on a person's feet. Having a very high arch or a flat arch can cause the ligament to pull and strain more. Going barefoot, that's another big risk.
Just even walking around, you know, I mean, it's kind of nice since it's cold here so much of the year.
Right.
In the summertime, a lot of folks do like to go shoeless.
A lot of people like to go barefoot around the house, too.
Yeah.
And just doing those day-to-day activities can actually create that excessive straining and pulling and cause the problem to begin.
All right. You know, you're talking about being barefoot. I know that there are probably a lot of shoes that you wouldn't approve of.
Right.
I think people buy a shoe for its looks, probably not for its orthopedic value.
Correct. Yeah.
So what should we be looking for when we're buying a shoe if we want to avoid problems?
Well, it's best to avoid shoes that are completely flat, you know, slip-on shoes.
Okay.
Flip-flops, sandals.
Yeah, those are so popular.
Similar design.
Yeah.
Actually, the ideal shoe would be like a running shoe, a shoe with a nice arch, a nice cushioned sole, just offering that kind of support.
Does it matter what age you are, what kind of shoe you should get? I mean, should you be looking for something different for a child versus maybe somebody in their 60s or 70s? Or?
Oh, actually, you know, a good supportive shoe is just it's just a good choice for a person of any age.
Okay.
People of all ages can, you know, develop these problems, like I say, running around in cheap shoes or going barefoot.
I look at some of the heels that some women wear. I've never been a big fan of that, but it's unbelievable to think that that could be comfortable for a very long time.
And in fact, it's, you know, it can be risky. We see people that actually turn their ankles trip, have, you know, various injuries from that type of shoe.
What do you do with if a patient comes in? I mean, is it an emergency if you have plantar fasciitis, or is it just something that develops slowly over time?
It's typically kind of a chronically developing problem.
Okay.
A person can certainly develop it with just normal day-to-day activities. Things like running, aerobics, mm-hmm. Put a person at higher risk. We see plenty of people that work on concrete surfaces for long hours that develop the problem. So it normally is a kind of a wear and tear type of condition as opposed to an injury that brings it on.
So what are your options if you find yourself in that situation, somebody comes to see you, mm-hmm. Does it necessarily require surgery?
More than 90% of the time we can get it better without the need for surgery.
That's nice.
It can take many months, but like I say, we can get it better without the need for surgery.
Well, how do you diagnose it, first of all? Is it through an x-ray, or do you do?
A lot of it's based on history. It follows a very similar pattern. We localize the area of pain, and that's typically on the bottom, kind of the bottom inside part of the heel. Mm-hmm. It follows a very straightforward pattern normally.
So once you diagnose it and you're saying surgery 90% of the time, you don't have to resort to surgery.
Exactly.
What are some of the maybe more conservative methods you could try first?
Well, starting out, we try to get the inflammation down, and that can be done through icing, anti-inflammatory medication if a person's able to take that kind of medication safely.
Sure.
Rest always helps, avoiding the high impact type activities and switching over to things like riding a bike for exercise, elliptical machine, swimming. Of course, being careful about foot support, wearing good shoes. Sometimes an over-the-counter arch support in the shoe can be very helpful. Strictly avoiding going barefoot, that's a no-no when you have this condition.
And as far as the pain, managing the pain, does that tend to be kind of tricky, or do most patients get relief soon after they would start a treatment?
We like to see a person experiencing improvement mm-hmm. within weeks of starting treatment. As I was saying earlier, it can take months for it to go away completely, but expect to see good improvement with treatment and some time.
So once maybe you get over the hump, and can you cure it? Does it go away, or is it something that maybe would happen again?
You can cure it, but you have to be careful about the things that brought it on in the first place to avoid it coming back again. Being careful about wearing shoes, good support.
Mm-hmm.
We have people doing some simple stretching exercises to ensure that the ligament isn't too tight and pulling too hard on the heel bone.
Okay.
Some people are just best doing the lower impact type exercise.
Well, most people, if the pain was bad enough, they'll do what it takes to prevent that from happening
again.
So, well, we do have a couple of folks who'd like to ask you a question, so we'll go ahead and go to the phone lines. Thanks for calling us. I think Mary Lou was our first caller. Are you there, Mary?
Turn it off.
Hi, Mary Lou. Can you hear
me?
Hi, Mary Lou. Go ahead with your question.
Well, I have bunions on both feet, and especially one foot. It hurts all the time, and I can't get shoes that fit. And I wonder what is involved to correct that or to take the bunion off?
Well, to correct the bunion involves surgery, of course, and typically it's an outpatient type of surgery where a person goes in and a lot of times given IV type anesthesia as opposed to general anesthesia. The surgeon then will correct the angle of the large toe joint to straighten the toe and remove the bump on the side. Person then goes home the same day wearing a special shoe that protects the foot and allows careful weight bearing. For the most part, just staying off of it and allowing the foot to heal, which requires typically about 6 weeks until able to start getting back into regular shoes.
Mary Lou, did you have anything else you wanted to ask Dr. McManus?
Oh, I've got Well, I guess that answers some of it.
Okay.
Thank you.
Oh, okay. All right. Well, sounds like have a happy customer there. So we wish her well. We have Paul. You have a question about some foot pain. Go ahead, Paul.
Yeah, hi. Thanks for taking my call.
Sure.
I wanted to ask the doctor about glucosamine and chondroitin supplements that I'm taking for diffuse foot pain. I just wanted to see what his thoughts on that were.
The studies have shown that glucosamine chondroitin can offer some people the same amount of relief as taking ibuprofen does. So it is a legitimate thing to take for pain relief. We don't know whether it actually repairs cartilage or bone, but like I say, it can be comparable to some of the anti-inflammatory medications and probably safer to take.
Paul, did you have anything else you wanted to ask Dr. McManus? I'm not sure if Paul.
Do you have a brand you prefer?
No, I don't.
All right, thank you.
All right, thanks a lot, Paul. Good luck to you. The one thing that I wanted to touch on with Paul, chondroitin and glucosamine, I mean, is that pretty common? I didn't realize it was comparable to, you know, what you would benefit from taking ibuprofen.
Mm-hmm. Some people.
Is that all over the counter?
Yeah,
the,
it
the
is.
The glucosamine,
yeah,
and everything?
A person can buy it at the local pharmacy, or the shopping malls have big supplement sections.
Okay. And those are safe to take even, or should you ask your physician first before
not
starting?
Not a bad idea to always check with your primary care physician about starting something new, especially, you know, even any kind of type of supplement.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah. All right. Sounds good. Well, we welcome anyone else to give us a call. The phone lines are open, and we're going to keep them open until just about 8 o'clock, so don't be shy. It's 969-2720, and 866 in front of there will make it toll-free in case you're calling us from outside of the Fort Wayne area. We've had a couple of callers, and certainly welcome more. We've got the rest of the half hour to talk to you. So getting back to the fasciitis, you said that 90% of the time you don't have to resort to surgery.
Exactly.
So if I'm assuming you would start conservatively, and if those methods are not showing effectiveness, then you do the surgery. What all is involved with that?
Well, we actually treat it in stages conservatively. Oh. First, the anti-inflammatory measures, mm-hmm. and the better support, exercises for stretching. And if a person isn't improving significantly with those things, then other things are available. Wearing a splint at night holds the foot in a stretched position that will keep the ligament from tightening up and can be very helpful. Going to a physical therapist a couple times a week, they do some intense deep tissue massage. They have things available like ultrasound that can help with inflammation. Some people do better being fitted with custom fitted arch supports, mm-hmm. for that support. Sometimes we'll go as far as putting a person into a walking cast boot to kind of treat it more like an injury, rest it, and allow for healing.
Yeah, you know, you mentioned those inserts, and I can't mention particular brands on the air, but I see these booths at some of the stores where you can go and stand on something, and I don't know, I guess it takes a picture.
Correct.
Of your feet,
yeah.
And then recommends a certain kind of mm-hmm. insert to buy. What do you think of those?
Those are reasonable to consider.
Are they?
They typically
okay.
will kind of connect a person up with an insert that matches the shape of their arch, and that type of support can be helpful.
Okay. I didn't know. I mean, I know obviously buying that kind of an insert is probably a lot less expensive than a prescription.
Correct.
That I would take.
Yeah,
it.
Yeah.
But I didn't know how effective it would be to buy this store-bought one.
It's always not a bad idea to start with that.
You
know, a lot of people get pretty good relief with that kind of over-the-counter support.
Okay.
And then it's the people that maybe try that, have some degree of relief, but could use a better, something more supportive that would go on to having the prescription fit orthotic done.
So all these, you're mentioning all these conservative steps, mm-hmm. that you would take.
Leading up to, you know, the surgery.
Surgery, yeah.
if after 8 to 10 months a person just hasn't gotten better with the conservative things, then maybe consider the surgery.
Okay.
And what's done there, the plantar fascia is actually partially released from the heel bone to relax it, so it's not not so tense and pulling so hard. At the same time, any scar tissue is removed, and that allows for healing.
So there's nothing artificial put in there. I didn't know if you could actually replace that.
No. Tissue. It's, you know, it's partially released, and that relieves the tension straining there, and removal of scar tissue promotes healing.
And how long are you looking at for recovery time from something like that?
A person's more or less healing, staying off their foot for a good 6 weeks or so, and then kind of easing back into supportive shoes and back to the normal activity level.
So are you in like some type of a cast or a boot at that
point?
Yeah,
a boot and like say limited walking.
Sure.
Staying off of it, propping it up, working on getting it healed.
And I'm wondering, you know, if a patient has this happen in one foot, how likely is it that the other foot will have the same issue?
There's always a big risk. The risk factors, you know, are pretty similar for both feet.
Right.
So it's not uncommon to see a person with it in both feet.
Well, if somebody is, you know, you touched on obesity as being an issue, and when you look at how delicate that foot is, we talked about this in the beginning of the show, what exactly happens to a foot when there's just too much weight on it? I mean, is it, does the, would somebody just expect over time to have an issue, or can it hold on for a while?
It's not uncommon for that extra weight to cause problems. It's been shown that every extra pound carried up here is like 5 extra pounds on your foot.
Wow.
So that can add up pretty quickly and just more or less lead to wear and tear type problems from just day-to-day walking and activities.
Sure. Well, yeah, if you don't have your feet working, that can be a problem. So
yeah.
Well, we do have somebody else who'd like to ask you a question. I think this is Joyce, and you have a question about something your husband's been dealing with.
Right. He has painful toes at the ends of his toes, I think toenails, and he has seen 4 podiatrists, and no one seems to understand how much discomfort he has. We've tried a lot of over-the-counter creams and lotions and gets little to relief with it. He's tried different socks. He can't stand to have any kind of a pressure at the end of the toes. And we just don't know which way to go.
It, you know, it sounds like a complex problem if he hasn't had relief with these consultations. A lot of different things can certainly cause toe pain. It could be a problem with the toenail. If a person has hammer toes where the toes are contracted. Other medical conditions can actually cause toe pain. Diabetes can cause a condition called neuropathy, which can cause burning and pain in the toes. So it's it would really require a thorough examination to fully understand, you know, what is causing this.
So Dr. McManus, obviously you're a podiatrist. Mm-hmm. Would you recommend that her husband see a podiatrist, or is this something maybe even a family doctor could handle?
A lot of times a person might start with their family physician, and then if necessary, that physician will probably refer the person to a podiatrist.
Sure. All right. Well, Joyce, good luck with that. I know that's just, it's horrible to have constant pain. I mean, that's something that you shouldn't have to live with. Yeah, so the good thing is there's almost always an answer or somebody that can help you. Well, we're getting flooded with questions now. So we have Paul. You have a question for Dr. McManus. Is it about gout?
Yes.
Go ahead, Paul.
Yes, I just want to know if gout is curable, or, you know, or should I see a specialist about it? Because the doctor put me on medication, and that seems to be working, but he said I need to get off meat.
Right. Gout is a problem caused by a substance called uric acid, and uric acid is a type of chemical that we ingest eating. Certain medications can cause it to become elevated. It becomes elevated in the bloodstream, and then it can create an inflammatory type of arthritis. So the key to avoiding that is to keep that uric acid down. Some people are able to adjust their diet, avoid the foods that are high in uric acid, rich meats, heavy protein type meals. Other people, it's more hereditary, so they will go on a type of medication to keep that uric acid down consistently. So in that regards, there wouldn't be a cure for it, but it can be medically controlled by taking the medication.
Paul, did you have anything else you wanted to ask?
Yeah, should I see a specialist about it or just let my doctor handle it?
Well, typically your primary care physician can stay on top of it and keep it under control. And as long as you're taking your medication and not having any problems or pain associated with it, then that's a reasonable course of treatment.
All right. Well, Paul, good luck to you. Thanks so much for calling us tonight. And we have another call, or a woman who called, Anne, I think. Are you still there, Anne?
Yes.
Thanks for your patience. Go ahead.
I'm diabetic, and recently the bottom of my feet, I don't notice it during so much during the day, but at night when I'm relaxing and take my shoes off, they're all prickly. Hmm. Is that neuropathy?
Could be the beginnings of neuropathy. Is it pretty constant pain while resting?
Yes.
Yeah. So it's not out of the question. Neuropathy is a risk of or a side effect of diabetes. With elevated blood sugar, the little nerve endings down in the toes can become damaged and create this painful condition, numbness, tingling, burning. So the elevated blood sugar is really the real culprit in this condition. Maintaining your blood sugar is very important in avoiding neuropathy developing. There are medications that can treat the symptoms of neuropathy if maintaining blood sugar alone isn't effective enough.
All right. Well, we wish Ann luck, and hopefully you'll be able to get that under control. Mm-hmm. So, but it sounds like it's pretty common for diabetics
it's very common.
Experience that. Mm-hmm. Okay. We're going to try and squeeze in one more call, if you don't
sure.
mind, Doctor. I believe, is this John? Are you still there?
Yes.
Hi, John. Go ahead with your question.
Can you tell me what they call these things that they make that they put inside your shoes?
Like an arch support? Is that what you're describing, talking about?
Yeah, I had a couple of them made, and the insurance wouldn't pay.
Yeah. Mm.
So I wore them for, I don't know, almost a year and a half. They just tore my feet completely up.
Sounds like you were probably fitted with prescription orthotics. A prescription orthotic is a type of arch support that's made from an impression of the foot. So if made correctly, it certainly shouldn't cause pain. It should be comfortable. And in fact, most people, after a little getting used to period, shouldn't really be aware that they're in their shoes, but experiencing the benefits of wearing them. So it sounds like there may be some problem in how those are fitting your feet.
Should he stop wearing them maybe and go see the doctor about that?
They're causing pain. You should stop wearing them. Probably go back and have them checked again, and sometimes they can be modified to work better. Other times, best just to start over again.
Well, and John, my mom had those, and I know they're a little pricey, so mm-hmm. for the amount of money you have to pay for them, I would definitely go see your doctor and see if something could be done about that. So, Thanks so much for your call. We appreciate it. And we've been getting some others. Unfortunately, we're under a minute time, so we won't be able to squeeze them in. But I did want to reiterate to people, obviously you're a podiatrist, mm-hmm. so a lot of times foot problems, it's okay to start with your primary care physician.
Sure.
And then a lot of times they, I imagine, probably refer their patients to you.
Correct. Yeah.
All right. Mm-hmm. And with insurance, does that tend to be most of the things that you can do for a patient? Would most people expect their insurance to cover that?
Yeah, it should cover it.
Okay. Mm-hmm. There's some specialties where I know it doesn't always work out.
Right,
that well,
right.
So.
Everyone's insurance plans are different.
Right.
But for the most part, the treatment we offer is covered.
Okay, wonderful. Well, this is Dr. Michael McManus. He's been a wonderful guest. We sure appreciate you being on the show. We had a lot of good questions tonight, too. So thanks to all of you for calling in and asking Dr. McManus questions about his expertise. And I want to remind you to tune in 1 week from tonight. The topic will be cancer care, and we will have a physician here answering your questions live. Same time, 7:30 p.m. next Tuesday, and Mark Evans will be hosting that show. I'm Jennifer Blomquist. I hope you have a great night. Take care. I know it's a little slippery out there, so be careful, and we'll see you back here next week.